at a time where the team which was so happily looking forward to defend the third World T20 crown and stamp their authority against the game, what do we have here? 2-0, the West Indies, the defending champions. There has been a massive improvement, truth be told, from 55 all out to 143 for 8 against South Africa. But the results aren't coming our way. What is happening to the Caribbean side? What can Pollard do, if at all, differently? In order to explore all this and more, I'm joined by Mr. Vernon A. Springer, who joins us from Antigua and Barbuda. And I see he has amidst him a lot of data and papers, which he's carefully sifting to perhaps make up a defined case for a team for which it's still not curtains, but the way they are playing, it could very well be sooner than later. Sir, what are the West Indies doing? What's been happening your end?
Well, first of all, let me thank Rapid Leaks for giving me this opportunity to share on your platform. And I want to thank you personally, Dev. It has been a trying time for West Indies cricket. They have now played some 33 matches in the T20 format of the game, won 12 and lost 19. And so, you know, being bowled out for 55, it's almost like going back, especially losing to England. But at the same time, let me take some time out also to congratulate Pakistan, who spiritually are turning up and really showing the world that, hey, we are here and we've come with a sense of purpose. And it shows you how powerful cricket is, because at least we had billions of folks looking at India, Pakistan. And you can imagine a world sport of cricket was able to be able to get 3/4 of the population of the world to be able to look at a game. And I thought that was special. Afghanistan, take nothing away from them. They also look like they're the dark horse in the race right now, and they're also playing some good cricket. So I think it will only go from strength to strength. But coming back to the West Indies, who are the defending world champions, you would know that in history, in 2007, when the ICC World T20 tournament started, West Indies lost their first two matches. In 2009, they won the first one and lost one. In 2010, they won both games, their openers. In 2012, they lost the first one and had a no result. And in 2014, they lost the first one and won the second one. And in 2016, they won the two first games. In 2021, they've lost the first two games. So it is now do or die situation in the last three games. So my objective would be, and you know, along with your support in terms of my shared article with you the last time, I said the West Indies had to get their GPS on. So we had the best start. Their GPS certainly was on because we had the best start so far for a very long time. You could say we were 7-3 without loss. But I think that we just missed a trick in when we sent Gale. I thought that Kyron Pollard should have come at that point in time.
Right. You know, it's interesting you speak about Gale, and you and I have perhaps discussed this earlier as well, but today I want both of us to go on record. Is Chris Gayle at number three really working out?
Dev, I don't know where this myth came from, and the myth would have started in the Indian Premier League. And one has to be able to understand why the myth started in the Indian Premier League. The franchise that Chris Gayle plays for has a method. And so Chris Gayle, based on what would have been happening and on his age and those factors taken into consideration, they had a plan. And when you go into a franchise system, franchises operate differently. Since that myth where Gayle was batting at number three, West Indies have also fallen into the same grace by going down the same myth. Now, I'm saying to you, Dev, I understand about right-hand combination and left-hand combination, but I'm saying, even if we start with a right hand and a left hand combination, let's say that's Evan Lewis get out. Are you going to send in a right hander or are you going to try and send a left hander? To me, cricket is cricket. And I'm saying Chris Gayle, if he is playing in the West Indies T20 World Cup team, has to open. If we work on the form of Lendl Simmons, since he got hit during the T20 Pakistan series in the Caribbean, he's been not the same player. In fact, he's got out slugging four times since we've seen him. He had a poor Caribbean Premier League. So he's short and he's low on confidence. I know someone will tell me, but Gayle is also low on confidence. But I'm saying that this is a big occasion. And big occasion players always step up. So my concept, and this is what I would have been saying if I was Phil Simms, the head coach. Chris Gayle, you're going to be given 3 games and you're going to the top of the order and you're going to go with Evan Lewis. You're going to be the father figure for Evan Lewis. That's it.
Exactly. And, you know, if I may just add to your point, since I'm today a disappointed West Indian fan, which you can actually read if you just put the cursor on my window. You know, when Evan Lewis sees somebody like Chris Gayle at the other end, that is automatically he's spurred by that confidence that, okay, the person who I actually grew up admiring, the person matching whom I'm hitting these sixes, he's there watching me. And if at all it's a question about those early goosebumps, then let Evan Lewis take the strike, you know, play the 6 balls so that Gayle can just, you know, just warm up a bit, watch the game from the other end. And then when the opportunity comes, he can just go in and expand and then just go boom, boom. Having said that, there are other issues as well, which are haunting the West Indies team, which can no longer be shoved under the carpet. For example, there are 3 critical problems. Number A, the vice captain, Nicholas Spooner. There's, you know, every game now is critical. They have to treat it like qualifying it to the finals, for instance. Puran has to step up. What is Hetmyer's strategy? I'm not sure. And number 3, I want to get your views on Jason Holder, who now finds himself in the squad, no longer as a reserve. But let's start with Puran. What do you make of his approach so far?
It's about building an innings. And it's about batsmanship. I think Nicholas Puran and Shimon Hetmyer are going to be the 2 emerging West Indian cricketers going forward. But they also have to take a sense of responsibility and game awareness on match day. There's no question about doubt about their talent and how far they can hit the ball. But the mindset has to be clear. Virat Kohli can hit the ball, but in playing against Pakistan, he had to graph, he had to adopt, he had to change his style, he had to change his attitude to be able to score 57 runs for India. Had Virat Kohli got out before, India would have been embarrassed. So I'm saying Nicholas Puran and Hetmyer or whoever comes into bat for the West Indies, even Evan Lewis, he got his first T20 half century because, as you know, in 2016, when he went there, he only played 1 game. But Evan Lewis got 56 off 20 balls. He has to look up on the scoreboard, Dev, and says, okay, I've got to start. So the deeper I bat for the West Indies, the more likely that I will be a motivator for the dressing room. Evan Lewis has to see that approach. And if you get 56 off 20 balls, why can't you get 100? Why can't you get a big 100, which could be able to send a message to the opposition? I think these are the factors that are missing out. And when I say you have to get your GPS on, folks have to be able to read the scoreboard, put your GPS on and realize, listen, I got 56 off 20 balls. If I'm here, I'm going to be terrorizing the opposition. Because imagine off my first 20 balls, I got 56 runs. If I stay there for another 30, how much do you think that I would make? 30 singles can add up to 86. And in the final 2 overs, I can still get to my 100.
Exactly. And this is a batsman who already has against his name not 1, but 2 T20 international hundreds. One of which came in Florida, a place where neither India nor the West Indies had any prior experience. And I still remember, as an avid fan of both teams, you know, one where I was born, the other I grew up supporting. KL Rahul also, you know, turned up a beautiful century. But that to me was Evan Lewis coming onto his own. And he's been an explosive. He's basically a fire starter. All that we need now is somebody in the middle order to just hang in there. Because so far, you know, and to me personally, I see a positive 55 all out and then suddenly 143. But having said that, now tomorrow's game, Shakib would be bowling, one of the best spinning all-rounders the game has ever seen, the white ball game, that is. It's going to be, if it is a slow and sluggish pitch, what kind of a target would you think West Indies should have in mind, if at all, they bat first? Or if they're not, what do you think they should be comfortable chasing? It's a hypothetical question, given their batting form that you're seeing.
The first thing is that West Indies have to continue to keep the pressure on Bangladesh. And so I think it is going to be important. Most likely, by the look of it, Holder will play, and Holder has good control. He might not have the pace, but he has good control. Russell does not bowl well. He's not batted well. He doesn't look himself. And so it is going to be very important in terms of the start from Andrew Russell. I also feel that Kyron Pollard needs to get himself in the mix because he bowls some slow cutters, and especially on those tracks in UAE. I think he will be very, very effective with his change of pace and his mindset, automatically taking some pace off of the ball. So the West Indies have to be brilliant in the field. I would make a couple of changes.
Yeah, please.
Evan Lewis and Chris Gayle has to go to the top of the order.
I so hope that happens.
I think that we need to get Chase in the mix and where he's going to bat.
Who do you play him for? You drop Simmons and you get him?
Simmons has to get dropped. So yeah. Chase has to come in for Simmons. And that's a no-brainer. Once Chris Gayle is fit, Chris Gayle needs to fire at the top of the order, because the Bangladesh, yes, they're going to come with Shakib Hasan, but they also got some good seamers which they want to be able to exploit.
Rubel Hussain is now back into the squad. Rubel Hussain, and he's an experienced campaigner, the right arm medium.
Right. So the objective really would be to send a message early o'clock. And I think that whether you like it or not, Chris Gayle is still a good player spin bowling on any given day. So it's a matter of in the first power play, him taking the risk and upsetting the uppercut of the Bangladesh lineup. They have to be sharper in the field. They have looked good, but they have to be sharper, because you have to be able to take excellent catches, because opportunities are going to be created. So once we create opportunities, then you can be able to put the pressure back on the Bangladesh team. Now, Bangladesh have lost, you recognize their games too. So they're almost in the same format as the West Indies. So it's a do or die situation. But I don't think...
Both teams, yeah.
Yeah. I don't think it is invincible for the West Indies, who are the World Cup champions, to be able to eke out a win. However you win, I just want the West Indies to win.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Speaking of that, one of a shocker of the news in the form of Mr. Obed Mekoye's injury, the promising left-arm medium pacer, a blossoming talent from the Caribbean. How big a loss is that? Were you counting on him personally to make his magic come through in some games? Or do you think it's fine, we can hold it well without him?
You know, Dev, the pandemic has really rocked sports around the world, mentally. Notice what I said, mentally, physically. And a lot of our sportsmen and women are going through and getting a number of injuries. I think because of the pandemic, some of the injuries or some of the players, some of the sportsmen and women are not being able to rehab quickly enough in time. And they so want to get back out onto the park because of income. And I think it is a real serious situation. Obed Mekoye, every now and again, a new injury keeps popping up all the time. But I think with time, he's one for the future. He doesn't maybe have the pace like a Shaheen Afridi, but his accuracy, I think he will be the next DJ Bravo. And that's why it was so important to have him in the same team with DJ Bravo, because I personally felt that Bravo was able to instill some of his tricks up his sleeve. So I feel going forward, the likes of Mekoye, Odin Smith, who I think has some rapid pace, Romara Shepherd, Sherfin Rutherford. I think these are going to be the emerging young guys that are going to be able to come forward.
Probably even Joshua James when he gets a game.
But you also have to also take into consideration, I like the look of Jaden Seals, who is playing Test cricket. I know somebody's going to say, yes, we don't need him to be playing T20 cricket, but you only want him to bowl four overs, and you want him to bowl four rapid overs like Shaheen Afridi or Raif. So I think going forward, we got a good mix in terms of what is going to be happening. But concentrating on the Bangladesh game, I think that the West Indies have to come out all guns firing. For some reason, Kyron Pollard has not won a toss yet. So let's hope that he does win the toss.
Actually, you're right. Those have been very critical tosses to lose. You're so right. You know, my God, yeah. Tell me one thing, Akil Hussain seems to be a very cool and collected customer. He's inexperienced like hell, but he's not in one game has he, not in one game has he let the inexperience doubt his performances. And I think, so what do you think is the imminent future for him? Would you, if you were Pollard tomorrow, open again with him? Would you do that?
Well, Akil Hussain has grabbed his opportunity with both hands. Because you would take into consideration that Fabian Allen be fit, there would be no Akil Hussain. But Akil Hussain has now come into the, in fact, he's come up the pecking order. Before, you would have had Carey Pierre, who a couple of years ago was the CPL player of the season. Right. You would have also had in 2020 Hayden Walsh, who's part of the West Indies lineup. I think that is something that the West Indies will be looking to trust forward to invest in. So they got two young, in fact, they have three spinners. You have Fabian Allen, you have Akil Hussain, and you have Hayden Walsh Jr. You still have somebody like a Rastian Chase who you could be able to bring into the mix in terms of the conversation. So I think the future looks bright. It is how you manage and how you bowl those players. Because in a short tournament like the T20 World Cup, where you've lost your first two games, you can't experiment. But I would say that Akil Hussain is an excellent fielder. And Hayden Walsh didn't bowl bad in the last game, considering in terms of what is happening.
Yeah.
So the future does look well. It's a pity that West Indies would have lost Fabian Allen, because the sort of energy that Fabian Allen brings to the team, that is irreplaceable. The only next person to Fabian Allen is a Hayden Walsh, to be honest with you, in the field. Outside of that, I think the West Indies have got some super athletes. But I think the test is going to be on Kyron Pollard, that winning the toss, I think, could make a difference. And the mindset of the batters. Yes, we are a power team, but we also have to understand that rotation of the strike, turning ones into twos, is also important. Because imagine we got off to our best start.
Right. And the accumulation of those dot balls, sir, that's not helping at all.
But we got off to our best start and failed to get to 160. That has to be a cardinal sin. How can we have 73 off of 10 overs? And the last 10, we're struggling to even get to 160, 170, which could be competitive. You saw even in the game when we got bowled over 55. Even if we got 40 singles, even if we got 40 more runs against England, we would have maybe even squeezed England even further with the likes of a Bravo and a Pollard and company. But it just shows that we are not getting enough runs and we need to get some runs on the board. If we bat first, we need to get some runs. If we're chasing, we have to make sure that we get our GPS on and we have to use our game awareness or cricket smarts.
Do you think that this team, and it's just a couple of last questions only, do you think this team just rushes it through in terms of this incessant desire to go big for the big shots? Or do you think the rush of blood can wait until unless a very important stance has been created first and then go berserk? You know, I use this analogy that when you used to see a Michael Jackson popular video, the moonwalk, which was a crowd puller, used to come at a certain point in time. He would first entice you into the dance steps and then he would lead you to the point of the moonwalk, after which he would just go berserk. And then, well, guess what? You and I would end up on the dance floor because he was so hypnotic. He was so charming. So do you think the big shots, I mean, of course, T20 is about big shots, but isn't it also about making, creating stands, creating partnerships, saving the wickets?
Dev, if you look at most teams around the world practice, they practice to see how far they can hit the ball out of the ground. And I think that is a mindset in mostly, even if you look at the Indian teams, and if you look at the international teams, it's how far you can hit the ball. And I don't have a problem because T20 is entertainment for the fans. And I understand that. But at the same time, you have different surfaces and you have different conditions of the game. We still have to respect the game called cricket because cricket is life. So you might be on any given day, you might be facing a Shaheen Afridi and the Pakistan attack, who are almost like a test attack. And so they're hurling, coming at you. You have to have good defense. You have to be able to defend the castle. And to know that, listen, today is a test match day. They got 2-3 slips behind, they're on top, and we have to graft this out. So I got to shield Shaheen Afridi, who is going to come and bowl his first three overs at rapid pace. if you're thinking about going hard at somebody like a Shaheen Afridi, who is attacking your stumps all the time, you could be dismissed, you could be embarrassed in a quick time. So I'm saying the mindset, if you check, Dev, most international teams, let's ask ourselves some questions. Why are they struggling in the middle overs? It is because of the mindset of the practices. Most of the practices, it's power hitting in the first 6 overs. When the middle overs come, they're struggling. There's no rotation at the strike because everybody, because you were spoiled by going hard at the first 6 overs, you feel that you can go hard also in the middle overs, and teams are losing their wickets gradually away. That is why the Virat Kohlis and the Kane Wilkinsons and the Steve Smith and those guys, they can now come in those middle overs and maximize and rotate. You could even look at the Pakistan batsmen and the South African batters. They just maneuvered the field around with the West Indies team. So the field settings that were set, they were turning ones into twos. Every time they hit the ball on the left side, they were getting 2 runs. That is something that the West Indians are not doing.
And it was like the camaraderie between Aidan Markram and Rassie van der Dusen was such that it was always understood that Markram is going to play the aggressor and then van der Dusen is going to come and play the accumulator, which is when van der Dusen himself can hit the big shots because his strike rate was 198 against Pakistan in the warm-up game, which the Proteas crushed them with. Having said that, my final question. You are standing next to the West Indies team that takes the field and Kyron Pollard. What do you tell him? Tomorrow is a big game. What do you tell them?
It's do or die. And when I say do or die, it, you know, somebody maybe might have to go home. And when I say somebody might have to go home, their career is on the line here for a number of folks. In the world of sport as we speak, Dev, people always tend to come at the head coach. People always tend to come at the chairman of selectors. People always tend to come at also the captain. And Pollard, even though he's an aggressive captain, the synchronization has really maybe not blended into the West Indies team the way that you would have seen it domestically. Leading Trinidad and Tobago in the Super 50 competition, Pollard easily is the best captain in the region. In the CPL, he certainly is the best captain. He now needs, the men now needs to follow him. And they need to understand now that this is a do or die situation in a complex world where the West Indian fans don't expect anything else. But we have to also ask ourselves some questions, Dev. Pakistan and India are cricket nations. At one point in time, the West Indies used to be a cricket nation. Do we have the caliber of players to be able to be considered as a cricket nation going forward? Do we have the right culture? I'm just asking these things. These are discussions that we'll have going forward and the next time. Is our mindset clear about what we want to do?
Also, if I may add, are we really hell-bent on winning? You know, is that desire really out there? Or are we just these popular bunch of wild creatures who are known to disrupt, who've just been unleashed from the cage all of a sudden? Because guess what? They carry this menacing reputation. But when it comes to applying just a bit of calmness and patience and just that cerebral approach, they keep getting found out.
Well, the good thing about it, Dev, is that let's look at the Darren Sammy-led teams that won the T20 World Cup. It was an opportunity where a number of West Indian players played in the IPL. Outside of the Caribbean Premier League in the Caribbean, we don't have any other avenue to be able to showcase T20 players out of the Caribbean. And I'm saying we now have to be able to find a system going forward where we need to start to export players to whether it is Bangladesh, to Pakistan, to the Lanka League or whatever. That is how we are going to be competitive. Outside of that, we are going to be behind the eight ball. If you see how many players Australia have, if you see how many players England have, if you see how many players New Zealand have, we have to now develop a core of players that are going to move around the world. Sherfane Rutherford took an opportunity and took off from West Indies cricket and said, listen, I'm going to go and play in Canada. I'm going to go and play in Pakistan. I'm going to go and play in the IPL. And you could see his success rate in the just concluded Caribbean Premier League. In order for us to compete, Dev, going forward, I'm not telling you that we're going to win another World Cup right now in a hurry, but we have to change our mindset, and we have to get our young players exporting out to be able to play cricket. Just to give you an idea, Dev, as we talk about cricket, West Indies cricket, there's a best of the best game taking place at the Coolidge Cricket Ground, home of Cricket West Indies, for the West Indies team as they get prepared for their test tour. Team Bratwett against Team Blackwood. Team Blackwood
is
batting first.
Is playing the game?
Yes, Team Blackwood batting first. They are 306 for four, with Nkuma Bana on 111 not out, 259 balls, 10 fours and 2 sixes. And Raymond Reefer is on 52 not out. Kyron Powell scored 31 on day one. Shane Mosley, 39. Jermaine Blackwood, the captain, 27. Kevin Hodge, 29. The wicket taker so far for Team Bratwett has been Rakim Cornwall, 20 overs, 3 maidens, 61 runs, 2 wickets. Vasami Pomal, 1 for 63. And Preston McSqueen, 1 for 43. So that best of the best game is taking place. It started on Wednesday. So Thursday, Friday, and then they will have another best of the best game before they head out. Also, just to let you know very quickly for your folks on Rapid Leaks, the West Indies women team will also be traveling to Pakistan to play in 350 over games, and then they'll get ready for the qualifiers. There'll be one of 10 teams trying to get into the women's 50 over competition, which will be New Zealand in 2022, February.
Huge year next year. But for viewers, having said all of this, Friday, tomorrow is a massive, massive day. And as Mr. Springer joins us from Antigua, I want to resonate his words once again. It's all about the mindset. So the West Indies, you have a clear choice, do or die. But listen, don't die. Just do it, yeah. Just do. Just win the game. Thank you, Mr. Springer. Thank you for joining us. We will catch up after the games wrap up against Australia and Sri Lanka. And then... let's see where it goes. Hopefully, rally around the West Indies.
Let's rally with the men in maroon, defending champions, the West Indies team. And we know that they can do it.
They can do it. Mr. Paul Arden team, all the best for tomorrow. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable time and the great insights. And please subscribe to our channel, Rapid Leaks, for news, views, reviews, and plenty of first-hand original widely researched content. You'll find it on www.rapidleaks.com. This is Dev Tyagi for Rapid Leaks, signing out.